We introduced the basic idea of policy gradient just now. I believe the idea is easy to understand. Now let's dive into a more detailed explanation. It will be divided into three parts. The first part is about the metrics for optimization. The second part is about the calculation of the gradient of the metrics. The third part is about how to use this gradient for optimization to obtain the optimal policy. Let's first look at the metrics. This section has a lot of content. No worries. We will go through it step by step. When reading books or papers, you will often come across two types of metrics. The first type is called the average state value, or simply average value. What is it? It's essentially a weighted average of state values. Let's look at this equation. On the right, V pi s represents the state value for state s, and ds is the weight given to state s. This weight is greater than or equal to 0, and the sum of all weights equals 1. Adding these values together gives a weighted average of V pi s. The resulting value is considered as a metric, denoted as V pi bar, where the horizontal line above V pi represents the average. Clearly, V pi bar is a function of the policy. Different policies will result in different values for V pi bar, so we need to find an optimal policy that maximizes this value. V pi bar is a weighted average of state values. It is a very natural choice for a metric. DS is a weight, and the sum of DS over all states S equals 1. In this case, DS can be understood not only as a weight but also as a probability distribution. That is, DS represents the probability of state S being visited. In this context, the objective function can be written in this form. This is based on the definition of expectation. It equals sigma S PS V pi S, where PS is the probability of selecting state S. Here, PS corresponds to DS, so these two expressions are the same. This summation, where values are multiplied and then added, can clearly be written in a more compact form as the dot product of two vectors. One is d and the other is v pi. Here, d and v pi are two vectors, with each element corresponding to a state. In this case, ds corresponds to the weight or probability of state s, and v pi s corresponds to the state value of s. Such a simplified expression will be useful when we analyze how to calculate the gradient of v pi bar. This is the first metric we introduced, but it's not fully explained yet. Why? Because we haven't discussed DS. Let's now see how to choose DS. There are two cases for this. The first case is when D is independent of pi. This situation is relatively simple. The second case is when D depends on pi. Let's first look at the case where D and pi are independent. Why is this relatively simple? It's because v pi bar equals the vector form d transpose v pi, as we said earlier. If d and pi are independent, then when we compute the gradient, d will not be involved, so we only need to compute the gradient of v pi. However, if d depends on pi, then when computing the gradient, we also need to compute the gradient of d with respect to pi. This makes the process more complicated, as you will see later. To indicate that d is independent of pi, we'll write it as d0, and the corresponding v pi bar will be written as v pi bar 0. When d is independent of pi, how should we choose it? The simplest choice is to assume that all states are equally important, that is, the weight or probability assigned to each state is the same. In this case, this is n, the number of states, and each state has a weight of 1 over n. When summed, it equals 1. This is essentially a uniform distribution. Another important case is when I'm particularly interested in a specific state, say S0. For example, the agent may always start from a particular state in a task. This state is denoted as S0. Starting from that state, I want to maximize the return I can get. In this case, I can't treat all states equally. Instead, I can assign a weight of D0 S0 equals 1 to S0, and give all other states that are not S0 a weight of 0. In this case, V pi bar becomes V pi S0, and maximizing V pi bar would be equivalent to maximizing the return I can get from starting at S0. What we discussed just now is the case when D and pi are independent. Now let's consider an important case where D depends on the policy pi. Here we select D as D pi s. This is called the stationary distribution. You might be familiar with dpi and stationary distribution because we discussed them in detail in the previous chapter on value function methods. Let me briefly revisit it. Let's say I have a policy and I continuously interact with the environment according to this policy. After executing the policy many times, I can predict the probability of the agent being in a certain state. Essentially, this is the stationary probability distribution. This distribution can be directly computed from the following equation. Dpi is a vector, and its transpose multiplied by ppi equals the transpose of dpi. Here, ppi is the state transition probability matrix. When I know ppi, I can directly calculate dpi. Of course, we may not know ppi, but it satisfies this equation. I won't dive deeper into the details here, as that would make things more complicated. If you're not familiar with it, or if you're interested, you can refer back to the last lecture or look into the book for more details. In short, dpi is a distribution that depends on pi. When I execute a policy, certain states will be visited more frequently, and certain states will be visited less frequently. The more frequently a state is visited, the higher its probability, and consequently its weight will be higher. States that are visited less frequently will naturally have lower weights.